Let's learn economics.
Very warm greetings to all of you, my dear comrades and friends. Last week, we had discussed that there is a very big campaign in this country which is undertaken by the party which is ruling India, that no growth took place in India before 2014. That's 60 or 65 years after the country gained independence were the lost years. And all the developmental activities, the progress and the growth came about only after 2014, when the BJP led by Narendra Modi came to power in India. It is very necessary to counter this argument, because the aim of this argument is twofold. Number one, it is to discredit the Congress, which has played a very important role in the National Liberation Movement, discredit it politically. And the second, by saying that during these 60 or 65 years, a kind of socialism was practiced in India through Nehruvian policies, you are also trying to discredit socialism as an idea of emancipation of the working people. And that is the reason why we must challenge this campaign and bring the truth to the people. What was the situation worldwide when India gained independence? We have seen that America was in a great depression, and to overcome that depression, Roosevelt brought the New Deal to the Americans. We have also seen that Europe, which was totally destroyed during the Second World War, tried to reconstruct its economy by following the Keynesian economic theory and projecting that we in Europe want to build a welfare state. While the objective of both the New Deal and the Keynesian economic policy was to revive the economy, it was also an objective to ensure that the growing influence of communism must be arrested and halted. It was under that particular situation globally India gained independence. And India, the National Liberation Movement, it is said it is the biggest mass mobilization of people in the human history. When working people, the peasants, the other sections of the democratic society, they participated in the National Liberation Movement. And the idea was not just to make the Britishers leave this country, secure freedom from the British rule, but also to ensure that we construct a society which is fair, just and equal to everybody. And when you had the participation of such a large number of people, the Congress as a leading party in the National Liberation Movement also had to come out with their economic thinking and their economic philosophy. And the Congress was holding discussions, inviting suggestions as to how we should develop our economy after we gained independence. And by 1994, a group of 8 industrialists, including J.R.D. Tata and G.D. Birla, they came out with a program which is commonly known as a Bombay Plan. The Bombay Plan is an economic charter which was given to the Congress, a charter which needs to be implemented after the country gains independence. According to this Bombay Plan, the industrialist, the capitalist said that we do not have the resources, the capability to develop infrastructure which is necessary for industrialization. And therefore, the state must play a dominant role in the Indian economy and it must develop the infrastructure which is necessary for industrialization. The capitalists, they will develop the industries in the consumer goods sector, and the government should give the protection to those industries from the foreign competition. So in reality, they suggested that the state must play a big role in the Indian economy. There should be import substitution and the Indian private sector must be protected. And when India gained independence, these were the policies that were implemented, accepted and implemented. To say that India, after independence in 1947 through Nehru, tried to build socialism in this country is far from the truth. Because if you look at the character of the Indian state, it becomes very clear that the Indian state is a capitalist state. How do you determine the character of a state? And you determine it by looking at the property relations and also as to who owns the means of production. And secondly, what policies the state implement, which class is benefited by those policies. And if you look at the developments post 1947, it becomes very clear that India set about to build capitalism. The Indian state was controlled by the capitalist class. They had partnership with the big landlords, because in the process of building capitalism, they did not destroy the feudal land relations. So the feudal landlords also became a part of the ruling elite in India, and this alliance was led by the capitalists, big capitalists in India. And if you look at the way the economy developed, the economy progressed, it becomes very clear that India is a capitalist state. That is the character of the Indian state. Now, India, as the Bombay Plan said, that state must play a dominant role. And for the state to play a dominant role in the Indian economy, it must control the savings of the people. The savings were encouraged. And the state set about to build the infrastructure through taxation, through deficit financing, and by mobilizing the savings of the people. And in order to mobilize the savings of the people, State Bank of India was created in 1955 and the Life Insurance Corporation was created in 1956. And thereafter, the state set about a large number of public sector industries, heavy industries, steel industries, coal industries, then in communication, telecommunication, Indian telephone industries, help the defense capabilities of the country. Hindustan Aircraft Limited came about. A large number of public sector industries came about. And along with that, because at that particular time when India gained independence, only around 18% of the Indian population was literate and 80% were people were poor, the capitalists also had to think about, the state also has to think about as to how to develop a skilled labor force for the industrialization of the country and for the development of the private industry. And in order to do that, industries, big schools of excellence were set up. Indian Institute of Technology, Indian Institute of Management, Atomic Energy Commission, all these were set up to help the industrialization of the country. We know that the public sector was created to give certain base for the industrialization and help the capitalists to accumulate the profits over the base, the infrastructure that is created by the state. So public sector institutions are also the institutions that are created for the capitalist development. Then we, to say that nothing happened between 1947 and 2014 is a blatant lie. The Indian economy grew. Despite the many crises that this country faced, the rate of literacy improved. Many schools of excellences were incorporated. Many industries which are essential for a self-reliant economic development were created, and an attempt was seriously made to reduce the poverty. So growth took place. But the question is that the vast portion of this growth was cornered by a small section of the capitalists, while the large number of people, a very small portion of development, went to them. And that is the reason why inequalities increase. But even then, if you look at the Indian situation between 1947 and 1980, if you look at it, in 1980, 1% of the top Indian population had around 12% of the national wealth. By 2020, 1% of the top Indian population controlled nearly 50% of the national wealth. And if you look at the bottom 50% of the Indian population, the kind of exploitation of the workers becomes very clear when you say that the bottom 50%, which had a share of around 13% in the national income, their share came down to an abysmal level of 2.8%. So inequalities grew. Though development took place, nobody can deny that development did not take place. Marwati car came during that period. The development took place. Roads were built up. Institutions were set up. But the fruits of the development, the major portion of that was cornered by the Indian capitalists. But by 1991, when India shifted its economic policies and opened up and adopted the neoliberal economic strategy, these inequalities further increased, and today India has become the second most unequal society in the world after Soviet Russia. No, it is not Soviet Union, it is Russia. After Russia, it has become the second most unequal society. And we have seen the increase in the hunger, the regression in the human development. And the last 7 years especially has been disastrous for the Indian economy because of the various measures the present government took. And the bulk of the pain had to be endured by the working people and the common people. So we have laid the basic foundation for the economic understanding, and from next week onwards, we will pick up one particular topic and deal with it. Like next week, we'll say, despite the fact that public sector is helping the capitalist development, why we are opposing the privatization of the public sector and why we want the state to continue to have a dominant role. And this has become very important after the COVID-19 struck the Indian health sector. And after the 2008 global financial meltdown. So why the importance of the public sector has increased and why it is necessary to defend the public sector despite the fact that it helps the capitalist development. So we will study this next week. Till then, take care. Goodbye.